Welcome to Calvary Bible Baptist Church. Those of you that are watching and those that are here, we thank you for being here. We encourage you, those that are watching, to come and join us. Before we get into the Bible study, we're going to have our weekly Bible trivia. In this weekly Bible trivia, we're going to fill in the verse. So the verse is Genesis chapter 22, verse 2. And he said, "Take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou blank, and get thee in the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I tell thee of." Anybody know what the missing word is? What is the missing word? He said, "Take thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou blank." Lovest. Very good. Lovest is the word, all right? And that's the first time the word love in any form occurs in your King James Bible. All right, we talked about that last week. It defines love between a man and his son. Very good. All right. This week's memory verse. Who wants to go first? Go ahead. Jesus wept. Anybody else want to go? It works best when we participate, but that's good. We got at least a couple people. So it's John 11:35, shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. Okay. Take out your pens. Take out your papers. Next week's verses. Galatians chapter 6, verse 8. This isn't a short one like we did this week. "For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Remember, thy word have I hid in mine heart, that I may not sin against thee." We want to hide God's word in our hearts, so we're going to do our weekly Bible verse, weekly memory verse. So Galatians chapter 6, verse 8, and will be next week's memory verse. Very good. All set. If you would, turn your Bibles this morning to Genesis chapter 22. Genesis chapter 22, verse 2. The title of this Bible study is Seeing Christ's Day. Genesis 22, verse 2. "And he said, Take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee in the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. And Abraham arose early in the morning and saddled his ass, and took two of his young men with him, and Isaac his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up and went unto the place which God had told him. And on the third day Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off, and Abraham said unto his young men, Abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship, and come again unto you." All right, if you would, let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for saving our souls from a devil's hell, Lord. We thank you for your word. We thank you for this book, Lord Heavenly Father. I pray you bless the Bible study and the message this morning, Lord, that we'd be edified, that we'd be encouraged, built up in the faith. And Lord, I pray that for your soon coming return, if not even today, in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. All right, here in this passage of Scripture we talked about last week, this is the passage where God tells Abraham to sacrifice his son, his only son, Isaac. And this is where the definition of love comes in, and it's not a love between a man and a woman, or between a husband and a wife, between a mother and her child. Love is defined here between a man and his son. That's what God has shown you is one of the greatest depictions of love is a man, a father towards his son. Now, we know a father and a son, God the Father and God the Son. God the Father sent the Son to this world to be the sacrifice. And that was the greatest picture. Greater love hath no man than this, that man lay down his life for his friends. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish." That's the greatest story of love right there. It's not a romantic between a man and a woman. It's between a father and his son. And here in this passage of Scripture now, we're going to move down. And if you would go to Genesis 22, verse 2. Genesis chapter 22, verse 2. "And he said, Take now thy son, thine only son. All right, well, that's a picture of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was God's only begotten son. Take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest. He loved that boy. He loved that boy with all his heart. That was his chosen seed. That was where God was going to bless. And get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon the mountains, which I will tell thee of. Now the land of Moriah is very significant because this is where Solomon's temple was built in Jerusalem, which was purchased by King David at the threshing floor of Ornan. If you want to go to 2 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 3, verse 1. Then Solomon began to build the house of the Lord at Jerusalem in Mount Moriah, where the Lord appeared unto David his father in the place that David prepared for the threshing floor of Ornan the Jebusite. So this is a very precious piece of property. This is a very precious area that God has told Abraham to go to. And God doesn't tell people to do things arbitrarily. You know, sometimes we think parents tell us to do something that makes no sense. Every time God tells us to do something, there's always a purpose and a point. And Abraham is told by God to go into the land of Moriah and offer his son there. So this land of Moriah is a land where the temple will be built. It's the city of Jerusalem. Moriah means scene of Jehovah. Scene of Jehovah. If you will go to Genesis chapter 22, verse 14. And Abraham called the name of that place, that's where he did sacrifice, Jehovah Jireh. As it is said this day, in the mountain of the Lord it shall be seen. So Moriah means seen of the Lord or seen of Jehovah. All right, if you would, back to Genesis chapter 22, verse 2. Then he said, take now thy son. Now this land of Moriah is not necessarily the mount of Moriah because of the end of the verse. Look at the end of the verse. And offer him there for a burnt offering upon the mountains, plural, which I will tell thee of. So the land of Moriah and Mount Moriah are not necessarily the same, although they're very close, okay? This shows that there's more than one mountain, which one of them being Moriah, okay? Another mountain that's located near there is south called Mount Zion. Go to 2 Kings chapter 19, verse 31. For out of Jerusalem shall go forth a remnant, and they that escape out of Mount Zion. The zeal of the Lord of the hosts shall do this. Now, Mount Moriah is where the Solomon's temple was built, but it's Mount Zion that the Lord's going to rule from. He's going to come back one day and rule in Mount Zion. So there's many mountains in this area. All right. This land of Moriah is full of mountains, and it's none other than Jerusalem itself. And here's a picture. Notice that this land is filled with many, many mountains. So you have Mount Zion right here, kind of in the north and the west. Then you have Mount Moriah. This is where the Temple Mount, this is where the temple was built. Another mount is the Mount of Olives. Okay? You read about that in Zechariah. That's where the Lord is going to plant his feet. Amen. He's going to plant his feet on the Mount of Olives. And so this place has many mountains, and it's called the Land of Moriah, which eventually becomes Jerusalem, the city of the great king. The city, Jerusalem means peace, city of peace. Okay, and so that is Jerusalem. This land of Moriah is full of mountains and is none other than Jerusalem itself. And this is where Abraham was sent to sacrifice Isaac. Remember, this sacrifice is in type of the Lord Jesus Christ coming. This city is also where Jesus Christ will be crucified. If you will, go to Genesis chapter 22, verse 3. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son and clave the wood for a burnt offering and rose up and went into the place which God had told him. Now remember, God has given to Abraham great wealth. A lot of times we think that if we're serving God, we're subject to poverty, and we're immediately going to be poor, and immediately going to have to be giving up everything that we want and desire, which may be happening if you're saved. The Lord may ask you to give up things. You know, he said to the lawyer, he said, sell all that thou hast, take up thy cross, and follow me. There's going to be a cost to serving Jesus Christ. But it doesn't always mean that it's going to cost everything all the time. Abraham was a follower of God and he had great wealth. If you will go to Genesis chapter 13, verses 5 through 6. And Lot also, which went with Abram, had flocks and herds and tents. See, they had substance. The land was not able to bear them, that they might dwell together, for their substance was what? Okay? Abraham was well off. Listen, I'm not teaching a prosperity gospel. It doesn't mean you're going to get saved and God's just going to instantly bless you from the rest of your life monetarily. Okay? There were many people in Hebrews chapter 11 that God said they went about with sheepskins on them, and they were brought down, amen? And the world was not worthy, and they suffered. There were people that died, okay, for the Lord Jesus Christ. But what I'm telling you is this. When you get saved, the Lord will bless you his way, not the way we want. You know, the Bible says, he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. A lot of people think that what that verse means is, well, God's going to give me what I want. But what that verse means is your desires are going to line up with God's will and way, and he's going to give you the desires of your heart as it lines up with Christ. You know, a lot of times, well, submit ourselves to the Lord and he'll give thee the desires. All right, well, all right, give me that Lamborghini. Well, that Lamborghini is not according to God's will, per se, but you want it. Your desires have to reflect what God's desires are. Lord, give me what you want me to have. Give me what I need. A lot of times what we need isn't what we want. A lot of times what we want would only destroy us. The Lord's got to give us what we need. Man, the Lord will bless us. He'll give us things. He'll give us toys and things to enjoy. The Bible says he's given us richly all things to enjoy. But you got to get that balance. You got to understand that the Lord may have some people be in poverty for him. Lord may have some people be in riches for him. A lot of people are just in average ways monetarily. And you got to accept your lot in life. You got to accept the Lord's given to you. All right? But you can't get carried away. The brethren get carried away one way or another, and they don't study their Bible. Feed me with food convenient for me. You know, don't give me riches that I forget thee, poor poverty that I would curse thee. You know what a lot of times we do is we have a false sense of poverty. I remember going to these youth events and these, you know, big events where people would get on fire for God afterwards, and they say, go and shoot up your TV and get rid of it and get rid of all your gaming devices and stuff. And kids would do it. They would throw all these things away, and they would throw away their gaming devices, their TVs, and then about 2 weeks later, they would buy them all back. Say, what is that? It's a waste of money. That's a false poverty. That's a false giving up. Now, the Lord tells you to give up something, give it up. And don't go and get another one. Amen? But the fact of the matter is we as Christians, we get led by our emotions rather than led by principles. When you're led by emotions, that'll only last a little while. But if you're led by principle of God's word, that's what's going to stand. Anyways, back out of the Bible study we're talking about. This is where Abraham saw. All right, Genesis chapter 22, verse 3. Genesis chapter 22, verse 3. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son and clave the wood for the burnt offering and rose up and went unto the place which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And this is where God, where Abraham saw Christ's day, as it were, mentioned of by Christ himself. If you will go to John chapter 8, verse 51. Now, I want to warn you, there's this passage of Scripture and this Bible study has been taken in error by a lot of brethren. This is a doctrine that has been taken in error, not of the lost world, not of the people that aren't saved, but people that are saved. If you will go to John chapter 8, verse 51. Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, he shall never see death. Then said the Jews unto him, now we know that thou hast a devil. Abraham is dead, the prophets, and thou sayest, if a man keep my sayings, he shall never taste of death. Art thou greater than our father Abraham? Yes, he is. Amen. Which is dead. And the prophets are dead, whom makest thou thyself. Jesus answered, If I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom ye say that he is your God, yet ye have not known him. But I know him, and if I should say I know him not, I shall be a liar like unto you. But I know him and keep his sayings. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Okay. Then said the Jews unto him, Thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. All right. Now this passage of Scripture is a discourse that Christ has with the religious leaders, the Pharisees. And what he does is he shows his deity. He declares his deity because the Pharisees do not believe that Jesus Christ is Son of God. And they believe that by saying that, that Christ is blaspheming. You say, how do you know that? Because you read the next verse, they're ready to take up stones and throw them at this guy. Why? Because they think that Jesus Christ is blaspheming by saying that he's God. And Jesus Christ has shown them that he's God, that he proceeded and came forth from God, and they reject him. And of course, they go back to Abraham. They're children of Abraham. They're the chosen seed. And God says, you reject me, you reject Abraham. And here in verse 56, Christ says something that's kind of profound. He says, your father Abraham. Well, they were using father Abraham as an excuse. You know, a lot of people, when they don't want to get saved, they don't want to serve God, they use God and his word as an excuse not to. That's where a lot of your heresy comes from. I don't want to serve God, so they're preordained and elected. I don't have to go out and witness. I don't have to go and testify. I don't have to bear the cross. So what is that? An excuse to not do what you're supposed to. Amen. And these Pharisees, they want to reject Christ as Savior and as God in the flesh. And so they use Abraham, somebody that both Jesus Christ and them know who. And they know that Abraham is their father, their patriarch. And he was the one that bore the nation of Israel. And they say, well, you know Abraham? You don't know Abraham. You're 50 years old. Abraham was way back when. And you're not the Son of God, so on and so forth. When somebody doesn't want to know the truth, they're not going to know the truth. You need to understand that. And Christ says here, John chapter 8, verse 56, well, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. All right? Notice with this dispute with the Pharisees, Christ shows his deity, which they deny. Now, this is how many brethren read this verse. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see me. They saw it and was glad. Is that what it says? Your father Abraham rejoiced to see me. That's not what it says. You know what? There's a doctrine. There's a doctrine that says, well, Abraham looked ahead to the cross, and Abraham looked ahead to Christ. That's not what the Bible says. That's not what the passage says. Read it again. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. Now, grant you, the day of Christ, Jesus Christ is the center show, amen? He's the one that it's all about. He's the one that we're looking to. He's the one that we're looking to come back. It's all about Christ. But that's not what the verse says there. And that's why there's a heresy among brethren, the grace believers we call them, that don't believe in any dispensation. They look ahead to Christ. They look ahead to the cross. They say that in the Old Testament saint looked ahead to the cross. The New Testament saint looked behind to the cross. And that is not the case. They weren't looking at Jesus Christ. They were looking to his day. Now, what is the day of Jesus Christ? Well, the day of Jesus Christ is a special day. If you will go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 2. It's a day that's going to come up. That ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that day of Christ is at hand. Is at hand. So the day of Christ is at hand. It's coming up. It's going to be in the future. And now the Apostle Paul's writing, somebody else was trying to say that the day of Christ already happened. And the brethren were getting all, the day of Christ happened? What happened? And Christ said, don't be troubled. Don't be soon shaken in mind. He says that day of Christ is at hand. It means it hasn't happened yet. It's happening in the future. So what is this day of Christ exactly, except that it's going to be in the future? Well, this day of Christ doesn't happen until two things occur. Number one, there's a falling away. And number two, the man of sin, the son of perdition, is revealed. If you would read on, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or troubled, neither by spirit nor by word nor by letter, as from us, as that day of Christ, not the day of God, the day of Christ, is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day. Well, what's that day talking about? The previous verse, the day of Christ, shall not come except there come a what? Falling away first. And that's what we're seeing today in America, in the world, and Christianity is a great falling away. Less and less people are getting saved. And people are still getting saved, don't get me wrong. But less and less people are following the Lord, living for the Lord, living the way God commanded them. You say, what is that? A great falling away. Don't get discouraged. You say, well, I am because people are falling away. Yeah, but that's the signs of the times. All right? So people falling away has got to happen before this day of Christ. And the second thing is the Son of Man, or the Son of Perdition, be revealed. For that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, that the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Okay? So when these two things happen, then the day of Christ will come upon us. Now many scholars disagree with the day of Christ, that it's an error in your Bible. I believe the day of Christ is an event I will be attending. Amen? And if you're saved in here this morning, you'll be attending it too. So what is the day of Christ besides a future event that will happen after the apostasy and the Antichrist being revealed? It's a day when Christ returns to take his church home, called by some the rapture, the translation, or the catching up. If you would go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 7 and 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 7 and 8, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's what we're looking for, the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Who shall confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ? So the day of Jesus Christ, Christ is coming back, right, to catch up his bride. Well, the Bible says that the trump of God shall sound, the dead in Christ shall be raised incorruptible, and they that are alive and remain shall be caught up together in the clouds, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen? That's the day of Christ. For further study, and I don't have time to quote these verses, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8, if you want to write these down, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 5, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 14, Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, Philippians chapter 1, verse 10, and Philippians chapter 2, verse 16 are all verses that talk about the day of Christ. Okay? When Paul writes, he writes a lot about the day of Christ. You want to know, we as a church, we're saved, born again. We're not going to hell, amen? We're not going to go through the tribulation, amen? We're going to see the day of Christ if we don't die first. Say, what do we need to be ready for? We need to be ready for the day of Christ. Christ is coming back. We need to be ready for the day of Christ. We need to be ready for his coming. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of who? Our great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. That's where we need to be looking. That's where we need to have our focus on. Now, when Abraham said he rejoiced to see my day, it's talking in reference to Christ's day, not Christ himself. Now, there's more to it, though, because if you go back, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. Well, what did I say about Christ's day? Christ's day hasn't happened yet. It's in the future. And he saw it and was glad. Well, how do you see something already if it hasn't happened yet? We'll go to Genesis chapter 22, verse 4. Genesis chapter 22, verse 4. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes. I want to stop right there for a second. What happened on the third day after Christ was crucified? He rose. what Abraham saw wasn't Christ's day as far as the rapture or the translation. It was something else. And on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto his young men, abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship. And that's it, right? No? And come again to you. You say, what did he see? Did he see Christ himself? No. Did he see the cross? No. You say, what did Abraham see? He saw the resurrection. That it was going to happen. That's what he saw. He saw resurrection day. You say, what happens on Christ's day? The dead in Christ shall rise. You want to know what Jesus Christ did on the third day? He died, he was buried, and he rose. You want to know what our problem is? Is we're going to die one day. It's inevitable. We're a dead duck. We're going to die one day. We need somebody that can bring us up from the grave, that can raise us up. I can't raise myself up from the grave, and neither can you. But you know who can? Jesus Christ. If you will, go to John chapter 11, verse 25. Jesus is going to raise a man from the dead, and Martha says, I know that he'll raise again the last day. Jesus says, you're missing something. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. When it says Abraham saw Christ's day, and he saw Christ, he's seen the resurrection. You say, why? Because he's about to sacrifice his son. You can't sacrifice your son and then have him procure the seed of Israel unless you have him rise. Abraham can't raise his son from the dead, but he knows somebody who can. Jesus Christ. Well, he doesn't know that Jesus Christ is Jesus Christ. He only knows him by Jehovah, and he doesn't know him by Jehovah's name. Knows that God raises the dead. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. You know what makes our religion, if you want to say that way, different from every other religion, is we have a Savior that's risen. We have a God that can raise the dead. We have a God that can cure death. No other religion belief system on this planet has that. I serve a Savior, but I don't just serve any Savior. I serve the risen Savior. We're going to die one day, and if you're saved, you can count on the resurrection. I'll be there in the resurrection. Will you be? I'm going to tell you something. That's a glorious thing. Praise God for the resurrection. Praise God for the resurrection that I know that Mr. and Mrs. Turner, my mom, Vinny, those people are not going to stay in the grave. They're going to rise one day. That's a comfort. When they plant me 6 feet under, I'm not staying there. I go to those funerals and I say, they're not going to stay, they're not going to stay, they're not going to stay, and that's the truth. They're going to break from that, eh? You say, why? Because I believe in a God that raises the dead. Christ says, I am the resurrection. He rose people from the dead, and he rose from the dead himself to show that. Abraham saw Christ's day, he saw the resurrection. Our problem is we're going to die, and it's inevitable. And people face him. People are scared of him. People don't know the beyond the grave. People are scared of the unknown, and they don't know what's beyond the grave. But if you're saved, you know that not only you're going to go to heaven, but you're going to raise again. You're going to raise again. We have the resurrection. You need Jesus Christ. He is your resurrection. Abraham didn't look to Jesus Christ, per se, at the cross of Calvary. He didn't see that, but he looked to a resurrection. He looked forward to something that God would give him. He couldn't see Jesus Christ because it wasn't revealed yet. If you will go to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8, you get there's a sect of Christians, and I'm sure they're saved. They love the Lord. They're King James even, but they're wrong here. Abraham couldn't see Christ in person. He saw Christ as resurrection. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8. By faith Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should have to receive for an inheritance, obeyed. And he went out, not knowing whither he went. All right? It wasn't revealed to him. If that wasn't revealed to him, how do you think he's going to see Christ on the cross? He didn't. By faith, he sojourn in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs of him, of the same promise. All right? Abraham didn't see Christ on the cross because he couldn't see Christ on the cross. You have people in the Bible that wrote things they don't even understand themselves, because revelation is progressive. And the thing is God didn't give all the revelation to Abraham. He doesn't give us all the revelation. That's why we have to walk by faith. It says he didn't even know where he was going. And the thing is Abraham, if he didn't know where he was going, he had to go by faith. All right? And if he didn't know where he was going, how is he going to know things in the far future? He didn't, but he knew what was given to him at the time that it was given to him. He knew what was given to him at the time it was given to him. You want to know something? And this is what I believe. Through the scriptures, whatever is given for our dispensation is clear cut and dry. So what's given to our dispensation? You must be born again. We're going to be translated. The man of sin is coming. Those things are given to our dispensation. You say, how were people saved in the Old Testament? Different dispensation. How does you want to know where people get messed up is on eschatology. You say, why? Because now we're getting out of our dispensation. You want to know what God does is he gives for our dispensation what we need. You know what Abraham needed? Whatever God gave him at the time. That's what people can't handle. Well, I want to know more. Well, you can't. You can only know what God's given you at that time. And you know what we're given at this time? We're given God's Word, the Holy Bible, the King James Bible. And we're given insight into the past and in the future, but we don't know the details of things beyond our dispensation. We know we have to get saved. That's clear, cut, and dry. If you get that wrong, you're going to die and you're on your way to hell. You say, what? That's given for our dispensation, though. It's not given for another dispensation. People get saved differently and all that stuff. You say, what we're given is what God gives us for now. And that's what we need to believe. Abraham was given what he needed then. And when he saw Christ's day, and Christ is talking about Abraham saw my day, he's talking about a resurrection. And that's about as far as I can go as a Bible expositor, as a Bible believer, and as a Bible scholar. I can't go any further, because I don't know if Abraham saw Christ on the cross. I wasn't Abraham. To say that he did, it's kind of assuming things. But I know he was looking for a resurrection. He had to. He knew only that was given to him at the time and walked by faith, believing God. And that's what God's going to do. You had a woman. You had a woman in the Bible who gave birth to a man being 90, 91 years of age. What are you going to do with that thing? All you can do is believe it. You can try to explain it away and explain it and all that. I mean, you got Stephen. Before he got stoned, he saw Christ standing at the right hand. How do you see Christ standing at the right hand millions of light years away beyond Alfred Jaconus? Well, you started disbelieving it. Now, do you believe that he saw Christ standing at the right hand? I do. You say, well, it's written there. You say, explain that. I couldn't explain that all day long. God gives you things, you just have to believe. Or don't. Yeah, clear, cut, and dry. I mean, you're talking about, I was talking with some Christians about how the doctrine of peccability, about how Christ chose not to sin, didn't sin. I mean, and there's things in there, it gets deep. But it's going to come down to, do you believe it or not? Do you believe that Christ died? Do you believe that Christ lived a sinless life or not? You know? You could argue things all day long about the Trinity of Christ, of God, and all these things. But it comes down to you to believe it or not. Believe it or not. Abraham was given knowledge that he needed at the time by God, and then he walked by faith. And that's what God does for us. He gives us the knowledge we need, and then we walk by faith the rest of the way. And we walk by faith by believing God at his word. It's written in the book, and that's all there is. Abraham wasn't looking to the cross. He was looking to something else. If you will go to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 10. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 10. For he, that's Abraham, looked for a city. He wasn't looking for Christ. He wasn't looking to Christ. He wasn't looking to the cross in the sense of salvation. He was looking for a city. which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. And that's what God promised to him. He said, I'm going to make you a nation, and I'm going to make you not only a nation, but a nation of nations. Make you many nations. I'm going to establish a covenant with your seed. The promise God gave to Abraham was his promise of nations. The promise God's given us is salvation through his Son, eternal life. Different promise, different time period. And so therefore it's different. So in conclusion, Abraham, when he saw Christ's day, saw the resurrection. He saw a God that had the possibility to raise from the dead. He saw a God that had a possibility to raise from the dead. And if you would, let's go back to that verse. Genesis 22:4. Then on the third day, there's typology. Jesus Christ raises from the dead on the third day. Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off, and Abraham said unto his young men, abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship. Now, if he didn't believe in the resurrection, that's where he would stop. We're going to go and worship, and only I'm coming back. His son's going to be dead. That's not where it ends. Abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship, and come again unto you. He believed that God's going to raise his son from the dead. Because he believes in a God that has the power to raise from the dead. I don't know about you this morning, but I believe, and my salvation and my stock is in a God who can raise from the dead. He's going to raise me from the dead. He's going to raise you from the dead. He's going to raise us from the dead if we die before that translation occurs. We believe in Jesus Christ as I am the resurrection and life. Praise God for that. Any questions this morning? Abraham seeing Christ's day. And a lot of brethren similar to you and I, you know, King James Bible Believer, Independent, Fundamental Baptist, they just get a doctrine. You got to be careful about getting a doctrine in your head instead of getting the Bible in your head. And what I'm saying by that is this. People teach things because they learn it from somebody else rather than from going in the Bible themselves and searching it out. And the problem is you're going to get doctrine that's not quite right. Don't stay that way. The Bible says that study to show thyself approved unto God. We should be becoming more and more refined as Christians when it comes to study. We should be getting things. We should be able to look at others' work and see where they're wrong, and look at the Bible and see where the Bible is correct. And as time goes on, so does revelation. It changes and improves. Let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for all you've given to us. I thank you for this day. I thank you for your word. And Lord, I pray that you'd come back soon as Abraham saw your day. Lord, I pray we'd see the day of Christ. In Jesus' name we do pray.